The cat is out of the bag. Felines rule the internet.
What was that?
What was that what?
In the movies, it's a different story.
What was that? What?
Cats are at best punchlines or curiosities, while dogs are much more likely to take central stage. It's no coincidence that you can find movies with 100+ dogs, but you'll rarely see two cats in a frame. There's a reason for it. Filmmakers have spread rumors, negative clichés, and harmful stereotypes about cats, which have kept them in the doghouse for far too long. In this video essay, we'll expose the anti-cat agenda running rampant in Hollywood and highlight the work of heroic people who have been fighting bravely for cat representation. From the beginning, the credit cat. Saul Bass thought that if you don't start a movie with a black cat, you'll get 7 years of bad luck. It was superstition that gave us the best title sequence in the history of cinema. It also started a tradition of movies that either open or close with felines, like the chromatically confusing Die Die, My Darling, in which a credit cat bounces. You can find a white pussycat in the opening of Diamonds Are Forever, a black cat in the movie The Black Cat, or even rhubarb. Now let's get into the meat of the narrative. Cats as plot points, or as Anne Bilson describes it on her wonderful book Cats on Film, The Cat Coffin. Savvy filmmakers will use feline actors to either drive or stall the story. Because let's face it, cats are just more in tune with the world.
See, I told you he could drive!
It's appropriate that it's a cat's meow to point out the elusive hairy lime in The Third Man. And this. A cat whine is the salvation of Sylvia from Marcello's advances in La Dolce Vita. The actions of a cat have the potential to drive the narrative, so when an alien Jonesy goes out for a stroll, while he might just be going after a rat, the reason he was written into the script was to create a pretext for Harry Dean Stanton to wander around in Nostromo. Is anyone there?
Jeez!
It was just a cat. Let's keep moving.
Roger Ebert, forever fond of fancy alliterations, called this trope Flying Felines of Fear.
What is up with that cat?
Is someone throwing it?
Hollywood wants you to believe that you should be afraid of cats, so they'll throw them at you from all sorts of angles in the hopes that you'll fall victim to their scare tactics. The fact is, cats will rarely jump at you from the dark. They're much more likely to announce their presence before you open the door. Jean-Pierre Melville, he knows what's up. In The Red Circle, he gave 3 cats to Commissaire Mattei. They eat and get fat like cats are bound to do, but most of all, they're good company. In Bright Star, there's proof that cats are great reading companions. In fact, they're actually faster readers than most humans. But then there's the dark flip side of the coin. While cats can be good company for good people, Hollywood has been planting them on the laps of criminals to destroy their reputation. This white furball has been miscast as the villain sidekick for 7 Bond movies, from Diamonds Are Forever through You Only Live Twice up until the more recent Spectre. This trope has been in anything from martial arts action films like Enter the Dragon to the godfather of mafia movies. Because of this stereotype, a cat on a lap has become the go-to cliché for evil characters.
Yes.
No.
Now you take that and multiply by 2 or 3 or 10 and you obviously get. The way you interact with cats says a lot about who you are. Bad Bond.
But wrong pussy.
Anti-feline filmmakers would have you believe that when a character lives surrounded by cats, she's either lonely, crazy, or evil. Lies, lies, and more lies. Stanley Kubrick is the worst of the bunch for perfecting the convention of crazy cat lady in A Clockwork Orange. The eccentric allurophile, a fancy word for cat lover, is an even older trope, dating back to Jean Vigo's La Talante.
I got all these cats.
But when it's all said and done,
cats?
There's a long tradition of cats who stand for something. Unlike what dog lovers would have you believe, cats not only have meaning, but they give meaning. A cat metaphor can be as simple as a montage to show just how cat-like a human can get, or how Bruce Lee is toying with Chuck Norris. A cat metaphor can come in the obvious shape of a cat named Timer who's playing a game of cat and mouse.
Should I do a timer?
Or a cat metaphor can get as complicated as a cat named Ulysses that can stand in for a folk singer's career, his life, or his sexual potence.
Where's his scrotum, Lewin? Where's his scrotum?
To sum it up, cats are metaphors for life. If you have one but lose him, you're a loser.
You'll never learn, you're a born loser.
Yeah, I even lost my cat.
Now if you have one and let him roam free, you can be just as free as him.
Holly?
I'm not Holly. I'm not Nuna May either. I don't know who I am. I'm like Cat here. We're a couple of no-name slobs. We belong to nobody, and nobody belongs to us. We don't even belong to each other.